Hi to all. I'll just give you a brief intro of Dr. Vasu Siddhar Saxena. He is a gold medalist in the field of oral and maxillofacial radiology with expertise in CT, MRI, CBCT, and 3D printing of oral and maxillofacial region. He is also director at Radin CBCT Center in Lucknow. He has also done numerous interactive lectures in the applications and future prospects of CBCT imaging and 3D printing. He has also national and international publication. He is also the life member of Indo-Pacific Associations of Forensic Odontology. I'll just request Dr. Vasu, he can start the lecture.
Hello everyone, namaste to everyone. As we are gathered here from various parts of the world. So the topic which I am covering today is certainly a different field. This is a new this is a new branch of dentistry which is getting explored for last few years. I must say ki around I think 5 to 6 years back there was not much awareness of this oral and maxillofacial radiology in the field of dentistry. The usual things which we normally do in our clinical practice is the intraoral periapical radiographs, and for the broader view we usually take the panoramic view. Let's discuss certain things more, and we'll see certain cases which I have gone through in past couple of years in the practice of this radiology today. Hello everyone, let's start. Am I audible, everyone? Let's say, what is radiology? Basically, when we start with clinical practice, definitely, as everyone say, ki, what we can treat when we cannot see. So basically, it is a science and art. Normally, we learn in all the definitions of all the subjects. In radiology, we can apply this as a production of X-rays is a science. And when we project those X-rays at particular angle to get a perfect image, which we want to visualize, which we definitely want to visualize. In the developing years of radiology, initially it was like we are looking at a picture in a broader way. Slowly, the things get evolved, get innovated, and we can see precisely at particular structure of the things. In dental practice, there are two things normally: knowing the truth or revealing the truth. Knowing the truth is like when we see a patient, when we see a particular thing, we already made up our mind that this patient is having this problem, so and so problem, we will go through this and we will treat the things like this. But what if that particular treatment will not benefit the patient? What if sometimes the patient, we did the particular treatment to a patient and patient came back after the treatment, sir, we are having the same problem again, and I'm having the problem at some other place or adjacent to the particular area. So let's start the practice by revealing the truth. And revealing the truth in dentistry is basically through the radiology, which we can see inside. We are the superman of dentistry. We can see inside any structure, basically the radiographic structures, where our role comes as a role of diagnosis. Before starting in any patient, we should know where and what to start. In our graduating time and post-graduating eras, we usually take the medical history, dental history. We go through the thorough examination, investigation, and diagnosis. In our clinical practice, we take a brief history of all these things, medical, dental. But the part which we should focus on is the investigations. Before touching the patient, if we do not go thoroughly through the investigation, we will miss certain part of the particular problem. In our field, the investigation which is utmost important is the radiographic. Other investigation procedures are like chair side procedure, which we usually examine in the patient, the blood investigations, you go for the patient or the histological examination for any pathological lesions. But for the radiography, in the radiography, we normally take normal radiographic investigation to find out any bony abnormality, any bony involvement of the particular case. we have been we are matlab I think we have been using these radiographs more or less, and I have given a lot of pictures of different radiographs, like a pcephalogram or a panoramic view, an intraoral periapical view, the white wing, the occlusal view, and the lateral oblique view. These are the and some other radiographs which we normally usually take in the college, in the study time or in the clinical practice. We normally take a panoramic view or an IPA. Most commonly we usually take these two radiographs. We take a panoramic view for the broader picture, we take IOPA view for the get better resolution pictures. These are the various shades of gray. In our field, we are only a gray. But as the things evolved, as the transformation begins, the digital transition takes up in the place, which reduces the efforts, which definitely reduces the efforts of our things. Normally, we have to load the cassette for any radiograph, we shoot the radiograph, we process the radiograph with the chemical processing techniques. Now it has been totally changed. All the things are through the cassettes. Now we call it as cassettes. We shoot the radiograph and we just process it through the radiographic system or directly in a digital direct radiographic systems. These things helped us in finding out revealing the truth in a better way. The IOPA's intraoral periapical views have changed from the conventional one to the digital one. Using the good, very nice IOPA machines, radiographic machines, and the intraoral scanners, which give us a better picture, better resolution pictures, high resolution pictures, which you can see the fine canals, fine pathological changes in the periapical regions. Similarly, the things have been changed from the conventional panoramic view to the digital panoramic view, which we can immediately we can see after the taking a scan, after taking a radiograph, which we can immediately see the radiographic picture on our computer, our laptop, or our tab or mobile. These are the innovations, these are the digitization which is helping us right now in day-to-day practice, in day-to-day life, which is making our things, which is making our treatment plan more easier, more more predictable now, which are helping us. What are the advantages of these day-to-day our radiographic digitization? Superior grayscale resolution, we get normally a superior grayscale resolution. Easy reproducibility, means if you want to take another picture, if you want to take another printout, another picture to see, it is easily reproducible. Reduced exposure time, these are the normal things which you normally read in these things. Increased VOV viewing, work efficiency get increased, diagnostic images are enhanced, excellent image quality we normally see. Excellent image quality. Now the latest innovation which has revolutionized the dentistry is the CBCT. Revolutionized the dentistry, because normally the oral medicine and radiology, this particular oral and maxillofacial radiology was limited to the digital imaging of the intraoral periapical view, the panoramic view. Now the CBCT has totally changed the perspective of dentistry. Now we can see any structure from any side, any view, customized view. We can plan the treatments. We can decide, we can discuss the treatment plan, we can compare the outcomes of the treatments, we can do multiple, and this particular thing is still evolving. It is under study, I am very much sure that this thing will definitely develop much more in the future. But when we should use this particular technology, why, when, and where? This is the basic concern of all the things, ki why we should take a CBCT of a particular patient, of a particular case, when we are getting a help from IOP only, which we are getting particular diagnosis from OPG or panoramic view only. Why we take CBCT? If we are taking a CBCT, then when we should take a CBCT? This is a basic concern of all the majority of practitioners. Here also, I thought it might be in other countries also. When to take a CBCT, where to take a CBCT, whether CBCT will help us in this particular case or not. So let's discuss, I will show you certain cases, why we take a CBCT. Basically, it has a capability of measuring areas of interest. Particularly, we can focus our area of interest. We can measure the area of interest in calculation will be more accurate and precise. This accurate and precise word is defined because if I go into the bore physics of this CVCT, it will be a more detailed one, but I will not go into that. But basically, you can say why it is more accurate and precise, because it has a we normally click volumetric box, volumetric picture elements are voxels. Those are of square shape. Square have all the surfaces have equal dimensions. That's why it gives us an accurate and precise measurements. Minimal projective distortions, because if we construct a wall using a square boxes, it will not distort much if we have all the surfaces have equal dimensions. We can visualize region of interest in any view, in any plane. Diagnostically driven section we can have, if you want to see a particular sagittal sections of the particular area, we want to see an axial view, we want to see a coronal view, we want to see upside down, we want to see downside up, anywhere. It is diagnostically driven sectional views. MPR views, surface rendering, maximum intensity projections, segmentation, we can do a lot of things. These all are technical parts of a particular CBCT things, but definitely it will help us to diagnose a particular thing. Something is hidden, something is hidden, and we applied a particular value to a particular thing and we project it. I want to see it as a projected image. We can surface remove, we can render the surfaces, surface areas. We can put up a particular boxes and pixels over a particular area. But there are definitely a lot of things which are giving an edge to a particular treatment plan or a diagnosis. It definitely improved. We can educate a patient on a laptop also. Definitely, this is digitization. We can have a particular picture, particular radiograph of a patient on our laptop, on a tab, on a mobile. We can show that to the patient. This is your particular teeth. This is a particular case. What we are treating is this. What will be the outcome will definitely it will definitely be different when we go through this particular thing line of investigations. We can communicate better when to take a radiograph CBCT. Basically, I'm focusing on CBCT as we all normally, I'm basically focusing on CBCT because IUPA and panoramic view we normally take and we normally know because it is a routine practice. When to take a CBCT? What the few questions you should, these few questions should definitely run through your mind. What am I looking for in this patient? What are you looking? Definitely, when you want to get a CBCT done of a patient, definitely you should think what you want to look for in the patient. What are the available imaging studies? Different imaging studies to evaluate the potential outcomes. Which imaging study do I want? If either you want to take a maxillary scan, you want to take a mandibular scan, you want to take a TMJ evaluation, you want to get a paranasal sinus evaluation, which imaging study do I want to evaluate in patient? Will my treatment plan change after the investigation or not? That comes later in the part of the presentation. These all are questions which definitely go through your mind. Where? This is the most important. This is the most important part of CBCT. Where do I take a CBCT of the particular patient? Let's start with cases. We'll not go very slow. Let's start our one cases. Cases like impaction. Let's focus on impaction. If we take a particular patient came with a complaint of pain in the mandibular jaw in the posterior area, and you must say clinically evaluated the patient and you told the patient that your particular the wisdom tooth is impacted, we must remove it. But when you take a smaller view of an IUPA, you will not be able to see root orientation. There are different views of in previous practice, root orientation and correlation with the adjacent structures. Mandibular canal and its correlation with root apices will not be able to appreciate. In the third picture, this three number picture, you can see the mandibular canal is running through the root surface. You can see a gray shadow over the root surface of the mesial root of the third molar. And you can see a distal root is distally oriented, whether it is dilacerated or not, whether it is operating the superior cortex of the mandibular canal or not. These are the limitations of these particular intraoral periapical views in a particular area. Like this in the maxillary occlusal radiograph, this is you can see a particularly impacted canine. This is a particular impacted canine. In this canine, we can normally say this canine is palatally impacted. But whether the canine is totally horizontal or it is mesioangular, whether the root of the canine is in the sinus or in the nasal cavity or not, What are these correlations? These are the physical limitation, whether is there any physical limitation to remove this particular area, a particular tooth or not, whether the tooth is, where should I approach from? From the buccal cortex or from the lingual cortex, where the tooth is located close to the buccal cortex or close to the lingual cortex. These are the certain mysteries we should, these are the certain hidden facts which you should reveal before treating the patient. And in these case, initially we were using this particular technique, old standard slop technique or Clark's rule, which you normally take a 2 radiograph of a particular thing. Will not go much into details. Slop rule is same lingual and opposite buccal. If the particular object is located on the lingual aspect of the particular area, it will move along with the X-ray source. And if the object is moving opposite from the direction of movement of the X-ray source, then it is always located buccally. So these are the techniques which we normally take, but this is very confusing sometimes. Who are not very much familiar with this particular rule, the day-to-day practice. In day-to-day practice, I must say ki every practitioner is not very comfortable in reading this particular slop rule, whether it is buccally or palatally. So definitely in this part, we will take a broader picture. Let's take a broader picture and evaluate whether the things are there in the inside the oral cavity. Still, we are getting confused whether the roots are buccally or lingually to the mandibular canal, or mandibular canal is passing between the roots of the mandibular molar, or the root apices or root apex formation has been completed or not, whether is there any pathology associated with the root apex or not. These are the things which we easily cannot determine whether it, with the help of panoramic view, it gives us a broader picture, but not the detailed picture. Will not be able to think. We can see a small crink over the mandibular canal over here. We will not be able to delineate the cortical border of the mandibular canal in the particular mesial root area of the left 3/8. And in this case, you can see the inferior cortex is running through this, but will not be able to see the superior cortex through the roots or through the tooth area. That means it could be a possibility that particular canal is running through the between the roots of the mandibular molar or either buccally or lingually. Here comes the part here what CBCT helps revealing all these things. How? This is a particular case of a mandibular third molar impacted, which I have taken in my particular center, in which the doctor was very much concerned whether the mandibular canal is in close approximation with the root apex of the tooth or not, whether I should approach. The doctor called me whether I should approach from the buccal or from the lingual aspect. Manega, you can see the picture, sir. Here you can see clear-cut mandibular canal along the lingual cortex, and the root apex is in very close approximation with the mandibular canal. In removing this tooth, if we particularly disturb the canal, there will be paresthesia to the patient. So definitely these images will change the treatment plan of the doctor. Initially, before taking a radiogram, before taking the CBCT done, he was relying on IOP or panoramic and remove the tooth. After the patient will get discomfort with it, I am having paresthesia also. So with the help of CBCT, which we can distinguishly decide that this particular thing is mandibular canal and it is running close to the lingual cortex. If we remove the tooth through the lingual cortex, that will be easier task. If we remove the buccal cortex, it is a thick, broad bone, we will not be able to remove the bone. So the plan has been changed. The distal portion of the crown is covered with the small portion of the bone. This small periodontal pocket has been formed between the bone and the root surface and the crown surface. So these things which we can easily determine using the CBCT. This is the case of mandibular third molar which we have taken. Now, there is a case of a maxillary canine, impacted maxillary canine, which we have seen in the maxillary occlusion radiograph. Similarly, this is the volume reconstructed view of a mandibular canine. And these are the coronal sections in the first window and the second window showing the axial view. In the coronal sections, we can see the root, the tooth surface, the tooth is along the, this is the palatal cortex, follow my yellow cursor of the laptop, if you are able to see it. This is the palatal cortex, and we can easily appreciate the root is close to the palatal cortex. I mean, this particular tooth is palatally impacted. See, it is not in the esophageal view. You can see the particular orientation of tooth is horizontal in the mesioangular direction. You can easily decide using this particular area. Again, the crown of the tooth is in very initially, which we are able to see in the previous view. The crown of the tooth is in close proximity with the incisive canal. Whether it is perforating or not, it was not clear. But using this particular axial view, you can easily determine, you can easily see the border of the cortical border of the outline of the incisive canal is disrupted with the crown of the tooth. That means if we remove the tooth without knowing this, we will definitely harm the particular neurovascular bundle in the removal of this tooth, particularly. So how this, in this way, the particular CBCT helps us in deciding our treatment plan. Another case of maxillary impacted molar. Above shown images are the cross-section images. You can see this red arrow, this particular radiolucent canal. This is our greater palatine canal, which opens on the palate. But while you can see this impacted third molar is in cross-section within the alveolar bone. If we approach without knowing these things, particularly in the steel view, we definitely harm the neurovascular bundle. And in this particular tooth, in the sagittal section, you can easily see the angulation of the tooth in the mesioangular direction and its position, whether it is perforating the maxillary sinus cortex or not. But we can easily demarcate the palatine maxillary sinus cortical floor. It is within the groove of the sinus, maxillary sinus. This tooth is particularly located in the groove of the sinus. It is not inside the sinus. So we can easily go through the our usual approach. Another case of maxillary canine. You can see in this particular case, in this particular area, you can see the maxillary canine is the apices of the sagittal show the dilaceration of the roots area. Here you can see the dilaceration of the root. It is dilacerated. Apex perforating the root apex is perforating the floor of the maxillary sinus. And you can see the additional mucosal opacification. This is significant mucosal opacification because of the tooth. This is dilaceration perforating the sinus cortex, and there is a significant mucosal opacification. And in the axis section, you can show that the root area is close to the anteromedial corner of the maxillary sinus. It is perforating through the anteromedial corner of maxillary sinus. So in these way, the CBCT helps us to decide our treatment plan, whether to remove this tooth or we can change our treatment plan, how we remove this tooth, whether we approach palatally, whether we approach buccally, whether it will harm the adjacent vital structures or not. So in this way, we can plan out. Yeah, definitely if I go without knowing anything, we'll definitely perforate the maxillary sinus and there will be oral-enteral communication also. So we have to decide whether to remove the tooth or not. And if we want to remove the tooth, then how we should approach. Let's go to another most common practice, the endodontic evaluation. Definitely in our day-to-day practice, most of the cases are the endodontic for the endodontic purposes. But how radiographs helps us? Common causes of endodontic failure, I can see if I'm not going against the endodontist, but I'm just telling you the things which normally you see in the our routine radiographic investigations. Inadequate filled canals. We normally see inadequately filled canals, missed canals, perforations, or under-assessing in the nature's mystery. This is definitely, we cannot assume with a particular tooth. Normally our literature shows a particular tooth has particular number of canals, but we definitely assume according to the literature we have already read in the books. Okay, this tooth have particular number of canals, this will have this curvature, this will have a particular ramification at the particular apical one-third area of the tooth. But if we approach, if we treated the tooth similar way as previous, after a few months, there is definitely a large radiolucency in the periapical region. How it came? I have done the perfect root canal treatment. The apex was perfectly obturated. The coronal seal was perfect. But how there is still a radiolucency in the periapical region? These are the common causes of failure and erotic failure. We can see in this particular IUPA, this particular image, you can see a different distinct entity in between the distal and the mesial root. What is this separate entity? Whether it is an enamel pearl, whether it is a separate, yeah, different root, if this is an extra root or what? What is it? In this particular maxillary radiograph, whether the root apices are in close proximity with the maxillary sinus, or it is within the groove of maxillary sinus, or it is perforating the things. Because if there is any peripical pathology happens in the later stage of the treatment, it will definitely alter the maxillary sinus outline. We cannot appreciate in these particular radiographs the number of canal, whether they are straight or curved, or is there any calcification between the canal, in the canals, particularly canal morphology. Is there any calcification or not? In these IUPAs, these are the particular small limitations which we normally face. We normally ignore and do the treatment, but in the later stages of the treatment, we normally see a patient is still having discomfort in the particular tooth. Another things, if we have a broken instrument inside the canal, what is the exact depth of the instrument in the root? Whether it is embedded in dentine or not, or it is freely present in the root canal area. We cannot decide. We decide in the help of, we have measuring tool in the our distal radiographic IUPAs. We have measuring tool, but that is dependent on our angulation of the radiograph. That is totally dependent. If you have taken a greater angulation radiograph, then definitely there will be a shortening. If you have taken a lesser angulation of the radiograph, there will be a elongation of the particular image. So how will we decide of the particular length, of the particular depth, or a particular area of the particular system? We cannot decide accurately. Still, this is a perfectly obturated root canal, but still there is a diffuse radiolucency around the mesial root of the tooth. And there is a distal radiolucency around the distal root also. You can easily appreciate. There is a diffuse radiolucency along the, it is extending up to the furcation area also, which you normally ignore. It is extending up to the crestal area of the bone also. And it will, this is normally have a, we can have a, like this, this is have a sinus tract formation also. It could be, but how good is the obturation? There is a good apical plug also. But why it is failed? Is it any fracture? Any missed canal? What is it? We can definitely use the CVCT in differentiating, in knowing the particular thing which is altering our treatment plan. Now in the particular area, we can see this is a different, in that particular IOPA, we can see a different entity. Was it a separate root? This is a separate root which is having a root canal. Now if we ignore this particular area, if we ignored this particular entity, the patient must not be having the relief of the pain from the pain. We can see in axial section, it is clearly visible, 4 root canals in 3/6 tooth. 1, 2, 3, and 4. 4 root canal in the 3/6 tooth with extra root and canal in the distolingual position. Normally, this is the extra root. You can see the bifurcation also from the other root. You can see the bifurcation of the particular root. This is a separate root and the canal in the distolingual position. In this way, CVCT helps us. This particular extra root have a dilaceration also mesially. This root is dilacerated mesially and lying close to the lingual cortex. So while doing our endodontic treatment, if we have perforated this canal, then we must have altered the lingual cortex also. If there will be any pathology, there will be lingual drainage. So in these way, we can assess, we can assume the things which will happen. We can plan our treatment. We definitely, in an IUPA, the dilation is not, will not be able to appreciate the dilaceration of the root. But in CBCT, you can easily appreciate the dilaceration, and hence you can alter the ear root canal procedure. So in these way, the CBCT helps in a better way, and definitely a better way. Again, a case of maxillary pathology, endodontic failure. This is a case of a doctor itself. He came to me, Doctor Sahib, I am having a pain in particular tooth. I have been root canal treated a few years back, but he removed our root canal material, but still I am having a lot of pain. What is the main problem? So I have done the scan done in a high resolution picture. In our high resolution picture, we can see an extruded material through the distobuccal root of 1/6. maxillary, right, first, molar. We can have a, we can see extruded material, and that is still attached to the root surface. That material is still attached, means that is through the root of the particular tooth. And this is altering the mucosal morphology of the maxillary sinus. You can easily appreciate the thickening of the mucosal lining. Means this is a reactive mucositis because of the foreign material. The body responds because of the foreign material and it thickens the mucosal lining. You can easily appreciate the, it is within, whether it is in this section, you cannot say whether the particular material is within sinus or it is buckled to the sinus wall or to the palatal to the sinus wall. Then we have a flexibility of the visualization. We can have a different view and a coronal view. This is a cross-sectional view, this is sagittal view, this is the axial view. You can easily appreciate the location of this particular extruded material. You can see this is the outline of the lateral wall of the maxillary sinus, and you can see the extruded material is inside the sinus, which is perforating the cortical floor of the maxillary sinus. This red arrow is showing you the location of this particular material. So in this way, now we have known, that particular doctor came to know, yeah, this is the main problem. I have removed the root. There is not much pathology in the periapical area. But what is the basic culprit? When he was biting on the tooth, particular tooth, patient was having pain. And that pain is because of the loaded sinus. The sinus is loaded with the heavy mucosal thickening. And when a patient bites on a particular tooth, that sinus gives us a pressure feeling. A missed an obturated mesobuccal canal in 4-7. There is a perforation of the mesial perforation of the particular obturated material. This is a case of canal transportation. While doing an inadvertent preparation of the root canal, the doctor perforated the particular wall of the root and obturated also. So these are the particular radiolucency you can see after this also. We can have a easily measurement of our remaining material, which is from the occlusal surface. We can have the depth of extruded material from the crest of the bone, whether the particular materials, we can have a good, then these measurements are accurate. I must say, because I have earlier told, because these all are square voxels. We can measure equal one-to-one picture. We can have one-to-one picture. So you have measurements accurate with any angulation, with any, in any plane, all these measurements will be equal. But these measurements are decided, we normally do the manual measurements. In the decimal phases, it can be altered. Means if I have measured 7.98, then somebody have measured is 7.62 or 7.12, yeah, 6.23. It depends on the manual errors, but not the accuracy. The accuracy will be, it will be a accurate image and accurate measurements. Now let's do the periapical evaluation. Certain things which you normally see in the periapical area, but we are not able to differentiate whether the pathology is located, how it is located, where it is located. It is location, its periphery and shape, what is the internal structure of the area, effect on surrounding structures. These are the small chair-side procedures to evaluate the periapical changes. These are the best views which normally take. These IOPs have the better resolution than the panoramic imaging. Excuse me. But how, where they are located, whether they are perforating the buccal cortex or not, whether they are perforating the lingual cortex or not. What is the internal structure? In our old standard books, it is clearly mentioned, when you see a radiolucency within radiolucency, that means it has perforated the cortex. Radiolucency within radiolucency, that means there is a perforation. But which cortex is perforated? It might be a buccal cortex, it might be a palatal cortex, but how will we be able to know that? This is the case. Radiolucency, in this particular diagram, when we see a particular diagram, if you can see this radiolucency in the center area is within this radiolucency. So really radiolucency within radiolucency is such a sign of perforation. But whether this perforation is lingual or buccal, whether it is affecting mandibular canal or not, what is the extent of the lesion? We take a multiple radiographs then. In this particular radiograph, I am not able to see the periapical area. Then we increase the angulation to cover the periapical area. When we increase the angulation, there will be shortening of the images. There will be distortion of the images. Will not be able to assess the proper extent of the lesion. So these are the shortcomings of these particular radiographs. Ki will not get the full coverage of the lesion. Is there any maxillary sinus floor involvement or not? In this case, you can see a pathology in the periapical area of the second premolar. You can see a clear cut, corticated outline around the pathological area. Whether this is a corticated outline of pathology or this is a floor of the sinus, which has been elevated. These are two different things. Whether it is a corticated thing, then it will be a cystic lesion. But if it is elevating the sinus lining, then it is a totally different aspect of the lesion. So these are the lesion. Cortical outline, is it in the sinus or not? So these are the things which we definitely get benefited from the CBCT. When you get a particular section of the area, we scanned particular area, doctor advised the particular scan of the patient and asked, this is the region of interest, my region of interest is the periapical pathology of particular tooth. He mentioned and he need to know the exact details of the particular pathology. We have taken different views. We have taken efficacy different views. This is a volume reconstructed view, axial view and the coronal view showing the dimensions of the lesion, the buccopalatal dimension, the mesiodistal dimension and the superior inferior dimensions. We can see the perforation of the cortex of the particular, perforation of the superior cortex. You can easily appreciate in this particular coronal section, and in the cross section, you can easily appreciate the extent of the lesion. It is reaching up to the floor of anterior nasal floor and causing the thinning of the cortical outline. You can easily appreciate that. You can appreciate the perforation of the palatal cortex. It is closer to the crestal bone, but there is perforation in this particular area. Superior extension of the lesion, you can see the extension of the lesion. You can see the buccopalatal expansion is there or not. There is no buccopalatal expansion. You can easily appreciate the normal thickness of the bone is as usually there is a cause. This lesion is causing the thinning of the buccal cortex. Definitely in the later stage of lesion, again, if you do not treat the patient, a lesion at the particular time, it will perforate the bone and spread into the surrounding soft tissues. Similarly, a periapical pathology of endodontically restored tooth, you can see in the cross section with extent up to the nasal floor, it is extending up to the nasal floor. It is perforating the buccal cortex and the palatal cortex. Definitely the root canal has been done very nicely. You can see the good obturation reaching up to the radiographic apex, but still there is a large pathology in the periapical area. And definitely this is the incisive canal outline, which is communicating with the lesion. That means incisive canal is involved. There will be a paresthesia of the anterior rugae area. If you test the particular area clinically, there will be paresthesia of the patient. If you ask the patient, he or she will tell, doctor, I have a different sensation over the anterior palatine area. So these are the things which we can easily evaluate using the CBCT. Another thing, you can see mandibular canal, the patient got removed his third molar, but still having pain. Definitely there's a carious tooth. You can see a carious radiolucency in the second molar involving the pulp, but it is way in the interval radiographs, it was seen as a good amount of distance between the mandibular canal and the apex of the distal root or the pathology in the mesial root. But he was concerned, he was curious enough to know the reason of the pain. So he asked for the CBCT scan of the particular patient. We can see the bifurcation of the mandibular canal, large, broad bifurcation of the mandibular canal. You can easily see the broad and wide bifurcation of the mandibular canal. And in this particular section, a radiolucency extending from the distal root apex and reaching up to the mandibular canal, which is also getting cross-checked with the help of cross-sections. You can see this thin radiolucency, crescent-shaped radiolucency over the mandibular canal. This is thing which we normally cannot see in an IOPA or a panoramic, definitely not, because the panoramic is a lesser resolution than IOPA. In IOPA also, you cannot easily visualize this particular radiolucency, which is extending up to the mandibular canal. And CBCT gives you an edge. Now, this is the particular case. This is the thing by through which patient is having pain.
Dr. Vasu, we lost you.
Hello. Hello, hello. Hello, sir. The program is running, sir.
So, Alan, on my side, everything is fine.
Am I audible?
Yes, of course. Please continue.
My screen is properly visualized.
Yes.
Still, the CBCT is not helping in visualizing of this. I hope the 3D view of the picture should come. everyone is getting the things. Should I continue?
Yes, you can continue, Dr. Vasu.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. So, we can appreciate the small continuity of the mandibular canal or the periapical lesion, which is extending up to the mandibular canal. So in these ways, the CBCT helps in a good way. We can appreciate the things. The most important, the most commonly, this is the most common thing which you normally get in a particular CBCT practice, implant planning. Implant practice is totally into the market, and everybody want to know the implant planning. Want to know implant planning, whether the bone is there or not. I've taken an IOPA, it is showing a good amount of bone. I've taken a panoramic view, it is showing a good amount of bone. I am getting a width of 10 mm, I am getting a height of 14 mm. And in this particular panoramic view, we can see good amount of image. So let's do the some practitioners using this and putting up the implants in the patient. But there's still a confusion. Some curious doctors have confusion. What is the width? What is the width of the particular bone, buccolingually? Initially, we used to width using the occlusal radiograph and the mandibular canal. The technique was old. We are taking the measurer and we are taking cast of the patient and we are taking the occlusal radiograph of the patient and measure the thing, graphical occlusal view, and we measure the width of the, we assume, because in the maxillary or mandibular occlusal view, the bone which you measure buccolingually is the maximum convexity of the bone. It is not exact. That maximum convexity can be at the middle of the bone, or it can be at the superior area of the bone, or it can be at the base. So you'll not get the exact position or exact buccolingual width. So in this way, where the mandibular canal comes, where is the mandibular canal? Whether it is below submandibular gland fossa, or is it above the submandibular gland fossa? In the shape of the bone, whether it is a parallel rectangular bone, or it is a thin bone, or it is an angulated bone, what is the shape of the bone? So these are the different questions which definitely change the outcome of our implant practice. Definitely. How it helps, how CBCT helps us in this particular case, these cases. We can see, we can trace mandibular canal in a CBCT. We can easily visualize the mandibular canal in case of particular CBCT so that we can see the mandibular canal outlined. There's a good amount of bone superior to the mandibular canal. We can do a good implant planning. We can put a virtual implants inside the bone and see the future outcome of the particular implant, how implant can be placed surgically into the patient. You can see in the cross section, there is a good deep submandibular gland depression. This is a deep submandibular gland fossa. You can easily appreciate this. And a good broad mandibular canal. It is around 2.5 millimeter. Width. Some have thin mandibular canals, some have broad mandibular canals extending up to the 3.5 millimeters. So you can easily appreciate the contour of the bone also. It is a round, smoothly etched bone at the crestal area. We can have a good contour on the lingually, but there's a deep submandibular gland fossa, and the bone, long axis of bone is lingually tilted. If you do not take a particular CBCT scan of the patient, if we rely on IOP or OPG, then we assume the bone will be straight. We open the flap, then we will be able to know there is a bone which is lingually tilted, but in the raising of flap, we will not be able to know the depth of the submandibular gland fossa and the position of the mandibular canal. We assume it must be below 10 mm, below 12 mm. But what if? Up now, in this particular CBCT scan of the patient, we have the depth of the mandibular canal is 12.2 mm. Means we have a 2 mm area to be spared to save a vital structure. So we take an implant measurement of 10 mm approximately. We take an implant of 10 mm and the width is good enough to sustain a good amount of good diameter of the implant. So by this way, we can have a good implant planning and we can give a doctor a good implant planning things. Yes, doctor, you can have this particular dimension of the implant placed at this particular angulation. And in this implant planning, we have a new innovation as 3D printing. We are preparing guides, surgical guides, which are more cost effective than the previous CAD-CAM guides. 3D printing guides are accurate and we can give you the good angulation of the implant, best angulation of the implants, accurate angulation of the implants, and the particular you need not to raise the flap also in a particular cases, in particular cases. So things are evolving, things are changing. We should also change and we should also adapt this innovative dentistry. In this way, we can join hands and practice more and practice good quality of good quality outcome. We can have customized planning of the implant. So suppose a particular doctor asking, I want to know the details of the particular planning. You just give me the particular detail of the planning. So these are the planning in our software, in the AIS software. We have general information of the patient, planning information of the patient, particular planning, which planning I have done it, the planning overview of the patient and the implant detail. You can have a particular details of the implant, whether the implant is placed in this particular, why the implant is placed in this particular direction, what are the things we need to be cautious when I placing this particular implant. You can mention all those things in the details and you can use your logo for the customization. So in this way, we can give a customized, this is the customized implant report, which you normally get doing the planning of the particular case. You can have all the things. You can have frontal occlusion, left view, right hand view, the overall planning scheme of the particular area, then the planning overview. You can have the implant, you can add, you can have a customized implant, the model, the size, the abutment, the sleeves, you can use the sleeves also, and the collision of the particular tooth with the surrounding vital structure or adjacent implants. You can have a clear cut view. Even the better things are, we have a quality of bone. You can assume the quality of bone here. You can see the irregular line showing the quality of bone which we are going to place implants in particular things. Like the bone quality is varying from D3 to D4. So before putting up an implant, we must know these things. Whether the bone is D3, whether the bone is D4, which type of implant system I need to use so that the outcome will be good, whether implant will get the primary stability in this D3, D4 bone or not, which implant system, which implant surface I need to use, how much torque will I get while placing the implant. These all things you can easily assume by knowing all these things. Yeah, now I can think this is the particular implant system I can use, this is the particular area I can place. After putting up implant, you can easily evaluate. In previous EBCTs, there was a lot of metal artifacts were there, but I definitely appreciate this AIS, Acteon imaging system, in which the metal artifacts are totally reduced. We can very, very nicely appreciate the contour of the bone around the implant. You can easily say whether there is a bone loss or no bone loss is there, whether there is a peri-implantitis or not. This is the best thing I have seen in this particular system. We can easily give a implant planning report. The particular implant is seen, if a particular implant has been placed supracrestally or at crestal level or subcrestally, or the implant has been merged inside the bone. We can easily see in this particular scan of the patient. You can give an idea to the doctor. Okay, doctor, you have placed the implant at a particular location. The orientation of the implant is like this. The bone around the bone around the implant has not been lost, so there is no case of peri-implantitis. You can move ahead with the particular thing. You can remove the particular implant and place another implant in different location or different site. So these are the advantages of CBCT which we can easily assume. In definitely IOP also, in the intraoral periapical view also helps in visualizing the implant position while doing the treatments, but in those cases, you cannot assess the angulation of the implant in buccal or lingual direction. In mesodistal direction, you will definitely know whether the implant is going mesial or distal. But whether it is going buccal or lingual, you will not be able to appreciate. So after putting up the implant, you should have a scan done to accurately assess your implant placement. Another cases which we normally practice, we normally see in our day-to-day practice is trauma. In trauma, primarily we focus on dentoalveolar fractures. We normally encounter the horizontal fractures, the vertical fractures, or hidden fractures which we cannot see in radiograph. This is the particular curious thing. Whether the tooth is root canal was okay, perfectly okay, root canal was okay, but the patient is having now a radiolucency around the distal root. In this six number of image, you can see radiolucency around the distal root. Why there is a radiolucency? There is no amount of any overhanging restoration. The root canals are properly done, but there is radiolucency. Whether the root has been fractured or not, this comes into the mind of the practitioner. Whether the root has been fractured while doing the preparation or while doing either after the treatment procedure, patient would be bitten on certain hard object and would got fractured during the process. So these are the things which we need to be very clear about the things, whether the tooth is horizontally fracture, easily seen in routine radiographs. We normally know the horizontal fractures are easily seen in radiographs. Such broad fractures, you cannot be able to, you definitely can, you can appreciate in the radiograph or IOPS. Vertical fractures are difficult to locate. Like this fracture, you can easily appreciate, but hidden oblique fractures in these cases, you will not be able to appreciate where the fracture line is. And in this particular case, our CBCT comes into the play. How it comes into the play, you can easily appreciate. This was a case of horizontal root fracture. But whether the root fracture was at the crestal level or in the subcrestal area of bone, whether along with the tooth fracture, there is a bone fracture or not. In IOPS, we will not be able to differentiate between these. If there is a middle one-third root fracture, you will not be able to appreciate whether the root is also fractured or the bone is also involved with it. Whether it is involved or not, you will not be able to appreciate. But in this case, you can easily appreciate this thick discontinuity at the middle one-third level of root. And you can easily appreciate the loss of bone. Means this is only a dental fracture. This is not a case of dentoalveolar fracture. Only dental fracture is there. So we have planned the treatment accordingly. Dr. Razmi, I will remove this tooth and I will go for the implant placement. So do the measurements along with. So this is the case of a particular tooth fracture. In this case, a particular prosthetically restored tooth, patient was having a little, patient felt little movement in the crown of the particular tooth. So he went to the doctor and doctor asked me, "Doctor, I want to know whether the crown of the tooth is fractured or not. Is there any fracture or not?" So we can easily appreciate the metal artifacts are there, but we can easily appreciate a thin irregular radiolucent line below our metallic restoration. So this is a case to reveal a crown fracture. Horizontally crown fracture. You can see this thin oblique fracture. In this thin oblique fracture, you will not be able to appreciate in IOPS, in maxillary IOPS or a routine IOPS, you will not be able to appreciate. And you can easily see the extension of the fracture line in a different manner. Initially, you can see this is horizontal fracture, it will extend like this. But no, it went upwards then. It went upwards and terminated within the dentinal area or cemental area of the tooth. So means this is not a complete fracture. This is incomplete fracture of a tooth, but tooth was not moving at all. Either you can restore the tooth or you want to remove the tooth, it's up to your decision, but you can now easily appreciate the type of fracture the tooth is having. This is called a hidden fracture. The palatal from the pulp chamber, extending from the pulp chamber and to the palatal surface of the root area above the subcrestally. It is not supracrestally, it is subcrestally. The crestal bone is up to this area and the fracture extends subcrestally. So these are the hidden fractures. And these hidden oblique fractures will not be able to appreciate in IOPS. And definitely CBCT comes into the play in this particular area. And you will definitely get the benefit of these things. And you can easily see the thin apical, periapical widening, periodontal ligament space widening of the particular tooth. Which this small changes you will not be able to appreciate in routine in IOPS. Another case of tooth fracture, you can say. In a cross section, you can easily appreciate most in the maxillary radiographs, number of superimposed structures are there in maxilla. Palatine bone is there, maxillary sinus is there. Sometimes if you do not take a particular angulation of a IOPA, you will get a zygoma also overlapped over the root surface of the maxillary tooth. So these limitations limit the visibility of the fine structures. But CBCT definitely help you in the broader and in a different pictures. You can see in the cross section, there's a thin discontinuity running through the root. In the sagittal section, you can easily appreciate the mesobuccal root of the maxillary second molar. You can see the maxillary first molar, in the maxillary mesobuccal root of the maxillary first molar. And this is a deciduous tooth, which is in the mesial area, in the mesial to the first tooth. You can easily appreciate the fracture of the mesobuccal root and the root apex in the close approximation with the maxillary sinus floor. And you can see a thin mucosal opacification in the changes in the maxillary sinus. So these are the small things which we can get a good picture, and we can plan our treatment accordingly, whether to save the tooth or remove the tooth, and what other precaution we should follow, while treating the patients. And definitely CBCT will help in these. See, this was the case. Definitely, you can. I must say, in a panoramic view, will not able to appreciate any type of fracture. But the patient was having pain. Patient was having a sharp pain while biting. So I thought that there must be a dental fracture. There, a doctor was said. I am thinking that there must be a fracture of the tooth. You can easily appreciate. But when I was going through the cross section, I have seen a thin discontinuity in the alveolar bone. You can see this lingual cortex has been discontinuous, and there is a projected extra projection of the bone in the lingual soft tissue area. While biting on tooth, this causing discomfort to the patient. So these fine and small structure we can definitely reveal while taking a CBCT. These structures cannot be visualized in a routine IOP or a panoramic view, because we will not be able to visualize these cross sections, these thin images. And these particular sections are of 1 mm, 0.5 mm, 0.2 mm. You can change at different thickness you want to visualize. Small or thin fractures, you will not. Sometimes smaller, small, very fine fractures get skipped through the scrolling through the image sections you see. So we reduce the sections of the image and we visualize slowly so that we can easily appreciate these particular fracture of the lingual cortex. So this is a case of alveolar fracture. Clear-cut case of definitely change the outcome. Where patient was thinking, I will remove the tooth, I am having so much of pain. Now it has been stabilized, splinted the bone, the patient was cured. Another thing, the facial bone fracture. Initially, in facial bone fractures, we normally take a broader pictures in routine. Okay, let's take an OPG or panoramic view, take a somatovertex view, take a PA view, different fractures we want to use you. Yeah, this could be a fracture. But if we want to take a, suppose we have taken an OBG of the particular patient, we have seen that there is a subcondylar fracture, in the left subcondylar fracture. Whether other fractures are also there or not, what about the posterior wall of maxillary sinus? What about the zygomatic arch? What about the sigmoid area where we can have a nasopharyngeal shadow over that particular area? We will not be able to appreciate the small and thin discontinuities. In this submandibular view, we can see the discontinuity in the zygomatic arch. But what about the discontinuity posterior to it and anterior to it in the zygomatic bone? What about this connection of the bone with the other bone surfaces? These are the routine radiographs. The limitations are the overlapping anatomical structures. Definitely, in the maxillary area, midfacial area, there's a lot of anatomical structures which get superimposed. It is difficult to identify the particular area of the fracture. But CBCT helps you in giving you all the details in a single view. You can have a particular area. I am suspecting a fracture of the zygoma or the maxillary sinus. Get a scan done of the particular area, and you can have an idea of all the fractures you want to know. You can easily think this is the. Here you can see the fracture of the infraorbital wall, and there is a herniation of soft tissue content of the orbit into the maxillary sinus. So there is a blow-in fracture. We can call it as blow-in fracture, which we normally cannot visualize. If this is a very fine blow-in fracture, we cannot easily appreciate in the panoramic view. You can see the lateral wall of the maxillary sinus. You can have a good, you can see the thickening of the maxillary lining. You can assume, you can see the different views, different views of the particular area to get an exact location of the fractious lining. And you can say a surgeon to go for this particular plating of a particular reduction of the particular bone. This is a case of very thin discontinuity of the subcondylar or sigmoid area. In the sigmoid area, this is very thin discontinuity seen. When I have changed the contrast of the particular image, I have changed the contrast to see this particular discontinuity. But it was missed while doing a scrolling, with when I was scrolling through that particular area. So I thought this could be something else. So I just changed the contrast. This is the again benefit of digitization, digital transformation. You can change the contrast, you can change the brightness of the particular scan, a particular radiograph, to visualize the hidden structures also. This is called a surface rendering. We can use as we give a normally technical term of surface rendering, which is normally as basically we use it as a changing of brightness and the contrast of the particular object. So you can see a thin discontinuity in the sigmoid notch area, which is extending up to the posterior border of ramus. And this is the fractured fragments have not been displaced. So this is favorable fracture. We normally call it as a favorable fracture of the particular area. So it is reduced and patient was relieved. The doctor came to know, this is the particular fracture which I was missing in routine clinical radiographs, which was missing in a OPG, not be able to appreciate because a good amount of nasopharyngeal shadow is over there. So these are the benefits of the CBCT while assessing the fracture line. The most complex joint of our body is this TMJ. And the number of cases that came to us, I'm having a pain in my ear, I'm having a different sound. Let's evaluate the bony changes of the particular thing. So get the OPG done. But in OPG, we will not be able to appreciate the much changes. This is basically in OPG, we normally see that condylar views are lateral views. The condylar views are lateral views and the frontal views are the frontal view. So the lateral view, we can see the anteroposterior changes. This is the TMJ views of the particular radiograph. Overlapping structures are the limitations. Superior cortical surface are difficult to trace. In the CBCT, you can see the sections. We can divide a condylar head. We can divide any structures like a bread of slices of bread. We can take one slice out. Either we want to eat it, then we can eat of the bread. And we want to visualize in the CBCT, then you can visualize the particular structure in a particular section. You can see a number of section, a particular condylar head. You can easily see. You can easily see this bone. Bone is thin, small, eroded areas of the mandibular cortex. This is small, thin, eroded areas. Thinning of, narrowing of the anteroposterior width of the mandibular condyle. You can see these small, thin, eroded areas. These are the lateral sections which have a good information about the joint space, cortical changes, or any remodeling changes in the younger patient, in a young adult patients, or due course of time, there is thickening or sclerosing of the cortical outlet. Those are the remodeling changes. In the coronal sections, these are the certain things which we normally see. The coronal section are the subchondral changes. Subchondral changes means in the cancellous portion of the condylar head, there could be any changes like subchondral degeneracy in case of osteoarthritis. Those are known as LE cysts, which we normally see, which we can easily see in this particular TMJ CBCT sections. In another case of a TMJ which I have seen, you can see a good sharp bony projection, beak-like projection in the left condylar head. Similarly, another beak projection in the bilateral, these are the case of the bilateral osteophyte formation. These are known as osteophytes. Basically, osteo means bone and phyte means projection. So these are the bony projection in the condylar heads, which are a sign of osteoarthritis. Serial section showing this. In another case, in serial section, you can see like this. Significantly eroded superior cortex. A pencil shape projection is seen on the superior cortex. This is a case of superior cortex, former superior cortex erosion of the TMJ. And in this patient, there was a limitation of jaw movement, limitation of mouth opening. Patient was having a strong discomfort. Both strong discomfort, patient was having a good discomfort, and he was having a pain and inflammation. Patient was having a increased temperature of the particular area. This is a particular case of arthritis. So these are the benefits which we can easily assume on CBCT. In this way, we can help. You can see in its upper center sections, they reduce joint space compared to the left side. Means patient is having different closure of mouth in different positions of the condylar. You have good amount of joint space, you have a reduced amount of joint space. So these are the things which when you can assume, even you can see, which we can give the treatment to the patient. Now you are having this pain, this problem, you are having that problem. I am treating like this. I'm going to change my treatment. So that's why CBCT helps us in treating the patient. Flattening of the condylar head, the beak, this is a good sharp amount of beak formation in the condylar head. Excuse me. These are the osteophyte formation, and CBCT helps us in remodeling things. In the visualizing this remodeling changes like this flattening, there is a flattening, means there's a loss of superior cortex, and along with that is the formation of the cortical bone. Means there is no loss of cortical outline. Means there's a remodeling changes is going to take away, is taking place, so that the integrity of the condylar head maintains. So beak shape projection of the, this beak shape projection is also any bony projection, any bony modeling changes or remodeling changes, which is not coming back to the normal, then it is going to be a pathological change. If it's getting back to the normal functions, then it is remodeling only. But if it is taking into some certain harmful structures to the adjacent structure, then it is causing some pathological changes. Pathology, so I'm coming to the last section of the particular. I hope I'm not boring you. I'm just showing you my cases, which I'm usually find in my day-to-day practice of radiology. Pathology evaluation. Basically, some certain pathologies are, bony pathologies are there. This case has come 2 days back in my practice. Initially, the panoramic view I was taken. I got the picture of panoramic view, and I can see a good amount of a radiolucent zone, a radiolucent structure associated with the impacted tooth. But I am not able to appreciate a cortical outline along the particular area. There's a thin cortex in some part of the lesion, but not to the entire lesion. Seems to be pathology attached to the crown of one thing. Is there any vital structure involved or not? Is anterior nasal floor is intact or not? Periphery of the lesion is not well noted. Whether is periphery is perforating the things, or it is within the bone, or is there any external root resorption of the adjacent teeth? If the particular pathology is causing the root resorption or not, or it is hampering the things or not. I have taken the scan of this particular patient. The coronal sections, you can see the coronal section showing a well-defined and localized pathology around the tooth, around this impacted tooth. In this previous view, we were assuming that it is crown of the tooth area. In this section, we can see the pathology surrounding the crown of the tooth area. But when we have taken the particular coronal section, we have seen the pathology is extending up to the middle one-third root also. It is involving like more or less two-thirds of the root inside the pathological area. It is clearly shown there is an elevation and perforation of the anterior nasal floor. Elevation and perforation of anterior nasal floor in the anterior part of the lesion. You can easily visualize, these are the axial section. You can easily see this is the incisive canal, and the incisive canal is not intact in the superior part of the lesion, and it is perforated by the lesion. Means there will be a definite paresthesia to the patient. So in these ways, we can measure the dimension of the pathology. We can assess the extension of the pathology, where it is going to involve the adjacent vital structures or not. It is displacing the adjacent tooth structures or not. Whether it is perforating, whether it is not perforating, whether it is the lesion is showing cortical. So you cannot see the outline now. You can see a good defined borders, but our cortical outline is not very much appreciable in this particular area. So diagnosis has been changed from a cyst to the tumor, or you can say whether the cyst has been converted into the tumor. There will be a needing of histopathological evaluation also, but CBCT definitely helped us to easily determine the extent and the nature of the lesion, whether the lesion is what. So in our routine practice, these are the changes we have encountered from the conventional IOPA, conventional radiographs to the digital ones. And then from digital ones to the more advanced, the CBCT imaging of the particular sections, we are definitely getting benefited. We are definitely evolving. We are definitely innovating the things which we should rely on. We should do the practice for the patient, and we should determine the things before treating the patients. And definitely these innovations and these advancements definitely helps us in treating the patient. And definitely, I must say, radiology is nothing without exploration of the curious minds. If you are not curious enough, you will not take any radiographic view. Let's explore more to solve more. Namaste. Stay safe. Jai Hind.